लास्ट टाइम वी सॉ द कंपोनेंट्स ऑफ टोटल सेटलमेंट, दैट इज इमीडिएट सेटलमेंट, प्राइमरी कंसोलिडेशन एंड सेकेंडरी कंसोलिडेशन. अमंग दीज, प्राइमरी कंसोलिडेशन इज अ मेजर पार्ट ऑफ दिस यूनिट. सो लेट सी द फैक्टर्स दैट अफेक्ट दिस प्राइमरी कंसोलिडेशन. सो दैट इज, फर्स्ट इज कंप्रेसिबिलिटी ऑफ सॉइल. And then magnitude of stress increase. Thickness of soil layer. And permeability of soil. Now we are well aware with the permeability. Thickness of soil layer means the thickness between the drainage path of the layer. So the place where the from where the pore water can go out. So that part will form the thickness of layer. And magnitude of stress increase means the change in the effective stress or increase in the effective stress. Now here we will see more about the compressibility of soil. So we want to quantify the compression that is going to take place in the soil. So for that we have to understand how this compressibility works. So why we are using it? It is for quantifying the magnitude of compression. Upon loading. There are several factors upon which this compressibility of the soil will depend, and the first is the soil type, and after that second is the stress history and the magnitude of effective stress. So let's see here one by one. Soil type means that how rigid the soil skeleton is, that these soil particles will be holding each other. So how rigidly these are holding each other, so that will define our compressibility. So when we'll put some load, because of this rigidity it can go under more compression or less compression. So it is depending upon the soil type. So we know that if we do the classification, there are two types of soils, that is coarse and fine, that means clayey soils. In case of coarse grained soils, the permeability is very high. So when the load is placed upon this soil, if pore water is there, this pore water can easily drain out, and because of that, if some settlement has to happen, it will happen immediately, and these particles are rigid also, so the amount of settlement will be low. So if we talk about the structure that is being constructed on a coarse grained soil, what will happen during the construction? During the construction period only, settlement will happen, will occur, and no further settlement. So for coarse grained soils, we can say that if it is coarse grained soil, then compression will happen immediately and the amount of compression will be low. These two points are there. And next is the fine grained soil. So for fine grained soils, we know that the permeability of the soil is low, and so if pore water is there in the pores, so it cannot drain out easily, cannot drain easily. So it means that if some load is placed upon this soil, so it will take a long time long time for this pore water to go out, and unless this pore water goes out, this compression cannot happen. So it will take a long time for compression, and the next part is the rigidity is also low in case of clay soils as compared to the coarse grain soils is less. So because of that, more compression takes place. So there are two points, that is because of this low permeability, the time taken in compression will be much more, that is it can be in months or years, and whereas in case of coarse grain soils it can happen within minutes. So that is the effect of soil type. Next is the stress history. Stress history means the stress that the soil has faced in the past. So because of this stress, the soil will behave differently. So if we are placing some stress sigma for the first time on the soil, so because of that, more compression happens in this soil. Because this kind of stress the soil is facing for the first time, and because of that, compression of particles will be more. Whereas if this sigma has been placed already and after that we place some new stress sigma dash and that is less than sigma, so because of that less compression will happen. Why it is happening? Because the soil has faced more stress already, so the already these soil particles have come closer and the pore size is small, and now if we are placing a stress that is lesser than this stress, so obviously this new stress will not affect the soil as much as the last one did. So this is the point on the stress history. Now depending upon this, some definition is there, that is peak consolidation stress. Pre-consolidation stress. It is the maximum stress that the soil has ever experienced. And depending upon this maximum stress, let's say it is sigma C, we can define our soil as normally consolidated if the present stress, that is sigma, if this sigma is equal to sigma C. So the present stress is the maximum that the soil has ever faced, then the soil is normally consolidated. And similarly, the soil is classified as over consolidated if this present stress is less than the stress that the soil has experienced before. It means that it is more consolidated already. We are saying it as over consolidated. And now a ratio is defined, that is over consolidation ratio. And that is the sigma C divided by sigma. So depending upon this ratio, OCR is equal to 1 for normally consolidated soil, and OCR is greater than 1 for over consolidated soil, and OCR is less than 1 for under consolidated soil. Now what are the reasons because of which this pre-consolidation happens? Let's say there was some building before, very huge buildings on the soil, and now you decide to demolish this building. Now because of this building, some stresses had occurred in this soil, and because you have demolished this building, now this soil is free of those stresses, but the effect of this stress has already taken place, so the soil has become over consolidated. Now if you make a building that is smaller than this, or any structure that is not producing as much as stress that similar to that which was produced before, so it will not go under much compression, is will be less. Similarly, due to erosion also it happens. So if let's say some rock is there on the soil, but with passage of time this rock has eroded, and because of that this soil has become pre-consolidated. And one more example is in case of glaciers. So glaciers, we know they move with time, so if some glacier is placed above it, so it will move away after some time. Maybe it will take years, but it will move away, so the soil will become pre-consolidated. So these are the some examples how the soil becomes pre-consolidated. Now let's see these curves that are drawn by testing a soil in consolidometer. So it is the E versus sigma and E versus log sigma curve. So this is the effective stress and void ratio. Now when the effective stress is increased in the soil, so because of that in this part this is part of the stress that the soil is already experienced, so it will go under recompression. Recompression means that this compression was there already, I mean it had seen this compression, but we are now again doing this compression, so it is the recompression part. But after this point A, there is a sudden breakdown in the structure. It means that this part of the stress AB, this is the stress that soil had not experienced before. So because of that, sudden change in void ratio will take place with the increase in effective stress. That means more compression. Void ratio is decreasing, that means the soil grains are coming closer because volume of voids is decreasing. It means that the soil is compressing. So in this part sudden compression is taking place, and so from A to B it is called as the virgin compression curve. And let's say after point B we start to unload this soil. So as we remove these stresses, because of that the expansion takes place. And so the volume will increase again, but this volume increase, even after this volume increase, the soil will not regain its original position which was here. Now after the when we reduce this stress to zero again, so the soil has reached to this point C, it did not reach to this top point. So it means that a permanent change in the structure has taken place in the soil. So that's what how we saw the stress history, that some permanent changes occur in the soil. Now after this point C, if we again put some stress, if we start loading this soil again, so this soil, this part CD of the curve forms, and the slope of this curve is not as much as the slope of this part AB. It means that the void ratio is not decreasing as fast as it was decreasing in the part AB. It means that the compression is less. Why it is less? Because the soil had already seen this kind of stress in this zone AB, and now when we are introducing the same kind of stresses again in this part CD, so this part of the soil is the over consolidated, because the soil had already seen the larger stresses. Because let's say this part, it has seen the stresses up to B, so this B, let's say this stress is sigma 1, so obviously in this part the stress sigma 2 is less than sigma 1, so the soil is over consolidated, so it will not go under as much compression as it was going before. So when this plot, the same plot is made between E and log sigma instead of sigma, so this AB part of the curve becomes straight line, and similarly this, say here it is D, so DE part is also a straight line. And similarly here also this AB part is the virgin compression and BC part is the expansion, and CB part is the reloading part or recompression we can say. So here we can observe that when the stress is placed on upon the soil for the first time, so this straight line kind of part happens. So here in AB part it is straight line, and again in this DE part, so this stress is also a first because it was subjected up to B, then we did the unloading, and then we did the reloading. So up to this point D, it was the older stress, but now from D to E, it is again the new stress. So when a new stress, new maximum stress is placed on the soil, so this E log sigma curve, it is coming out to be a straight line. So depending upon that, a coefficient is defined or index is defined, that is called as compression index, and it is defined for normally consolidated soil. How we know the soil is normally consolidated? So as I said, when some load is placed for the first time, the maximum load is placed for the first time, that is happening in this part AB, and similar it is happening in the part DE. So this line remains a straight line. This curve becomes a straight line in that portion. So for that we are defining our index, that is the slope of this straight line. Let's say here the void ratio is E1 and here it is E2. The similar stress is here sigma 1 and sigma 2. This is sigma 1 and sigma 2. So the compression index is equal to CC, that is E1 minus E2 divided by log sigma 2 minus log sigma 1, and that is base 10. So CC is equal to delta E divided by log n sigma 2 upon sigma 1. So this parameter is defined for normally consolidated soil, and it is not a function of effective stress. So as we saw here that AB part and DE part is a straight line, and this straight line is almost the same. If we did not have done this expansion part or this reloading part, so this soil would have gone upon this path AB DE. So that is a straight line, and the slope is not changing of that straight line. So we are taking the slope as the compression index, so that is not a function of effective stress. And so here we found out that for a normally consolidated soil, E versus log sigma curve is a straight line. E versus log sigma is a straight line. And for a over consolidated soil, what happens? Let's say for a over consolidated soil. So here, as I said, that in this reloading part or recompression, as we can call it, so this is the part of stress that is not the maximum stress that the soil has faced. Soil had faced up to the maximum stress up to B, but this stress is less than B. So this part of the soil, as I said, it is the over consolidated soil. And how this curve is looking? It is the convex upward curve. So here we can say that for a over consolidated soil, E versus log sigma curve is a convex upward curve. So that is it. That is the part for over consolidated, it is a convex upward, and for normally consolidated, it is a straight line. Now in this expansion part, in the same plot, when expansion is happening, that means when we are removing the loads in this part B to C, when we are going B to C, when we are decreasing our stresses, so the volume of the soil is increasing. I mean that the void ratio is increasing. Void ratio is increasing, that means the volume of soil is increasing. That means the soil is swelling up. So for this part, another index is defined, that is the swelling index. Let's say it is denoted as CS, so we can define it here as, say here the soil is, it is E1 and this is log sigma 1, and we are going from here to here, so up at this point it is E2 and here it is log sigma 2. So the slope of this line is E2 minus E1 divided by log sigma 1 upon log sigma 2. So this is how we can define the swelling index. Now next factor affecting compressibility is the role of effective stress. So as I discussed in the last video also, that when on a soil sample, when some stress increase takes place, so if pore water is there and the permeability is low, so this water cannot drain out easily. So the stresses will build up in the soil, will build up in this pore water. So if this piezometer is inserted, so it will rise above this its hydrostatic level, and because of that flow of water will take place, and after this it has reached the hydrostatic condition again, then only after that the effective stress will increase in the soil, and simultaneously the settlement, which means the compression, takes place. So from here we can say that when the effective stress is increased, the compression takes place, that means the void ratio decreases. So here also, using the E versus sigma plot, that is sigma here and E here, another index is defined or ratio is defined, that is the slope of this E versus sigma plot. So we are, if we take a small part of the plot, because we saw it was a curved part, in this it is curved, but if we can take a small part, so we can say it is a straight line. So let's say here the void ratio is E0, and then here it is E1, and then here it is E2. So the stress here is sigma naught and sigma 1 and sigma 2. So let's say that sigma 1 minus sigma naught is equal to delta sigma, and similarly sigma 2 minus sigma 1 is also equal to delta sigma. So we are, the increment in the stress, if we keep it equal, so from here we can see that first the change in void ratio is delta E1, that is E1 minus E0, and the second change in void ratio is E2 minus E1, that is delta E2. So what happens, this delta E2 will be less than delta E1 for the same increase in effective stress. So why is it happening? Because when the first time you are putting a stress increase of delta sigma, the soil is going under compression, the void ratio is decreasing. So after this stress increase, let's say the void ratio has decreased, and so from first the void ratio was E0, and after this stress increase of delta sigma, we have reached the part E1. So this new void ratio is E1. So we know that this new void ratio is smaller than E0. That means that pore size is small now. Now pore is small, that means if we again put an increase of delta sigma in this soil, so the new void ratio is E2. So obviously if pore is small, so it cannot go further up to this amount delta E. So this new increase will obviously be less than the last increase, because the pores have decreased in size, so there is no further place where these particles can move. And if we keep on increasing this delta sigma, so this pore will further decrease and the compression will decrease. It means that with increase in effective stress, the compressibility of soil decreases. So the slope of this line, we can define it as coefficient of compressibility, and it is denoted as AV. It is equal to delta E upon delta sigma. So here we can see that when delta sigma increases, delta E decreases. It means that it will be a negative quantity. Negative quantity. But as we are saying here itself that it is a negative quantity, so if it is there in a question, so AV will use positive sign for it. Because here already we have said that it is a negative quantity. So these were the ratios or indices that are defined for compressibility of the soil. So first we saw the compression index, and second is the coefficient of compressibility, and for the swelling we defined the swelling index. So these two are for volume decrease and this is for volume increase. Now apart from these, there is one more coefficient of volume compressibility. So that we will see later when we read about the experiments that are used for consolidation. So these three are the coefficients that are used to quantify the compression. And after that there will be another coefficient, that is coefficient of consolidation. So I am telling here itself this thing because you should not confuse between these coefficients and the coefficient of consolidation. This happens because it all sounds similar. So in this lecture I have talked about the compressibility, and initially we have seen the ratios that are defined for compression, and later we'll see for consolidation, so don't mix it up. And that's all for this one. Thank you.